I had no money left to buy a microphone clip, okay? This is what we're stuck to. Oh, hello there, YouTube. I'm Quinn of Snazzy Labs, and this is my hi-fi setup. Everyone has a hobby, right? Some hobbies are cool, and some hobbies are, well, they're like mine. The hi-fi world is filled with a bunch of snake oil. A lot of it is crap. Some equipment is measurably scientifically better, but most of it, most of it, no. It's owned by old crazy coots who pretend to be able to hear the difference when barely an oscilloscope can measure a difference, if any. Nice try, old people. You can't hear me when I yell your name across the room. You think you can hear a difference in a cable? Anyway, I have built up an interest in the hobby, and I've tried to balance it so that I have a rational setup, one that makes sense, one that is measurably decent, but one that's enjoyable and fun to listen to. I have a mixture of new equipment. I have a home server over here that runs music off of local stores, and then I also have streaming music. I have, of course, a record player, which, while being a new record player, is a very old technology. And then I have vintage gear here. This is a Technics RS1700 reel-to-reel deck, which is more than 40 years old. And all of this hardware comes in to create a really cool, really fancy, really, how do I say, enjoyable experience. Let's talk about it. This is where all of the magic begins, and this is kind of the part that I like the most because I made this stuff. These are DIY speakers. There's a famous loudspeaker designer named Siegfried Linkwitz. You look at these speakers and they look very strange, unlike any other speakers you've probably seen. They use what's called an open baffle design. And so they look kind of quirky and they look kind of strange, but the measurements don't lie. You look at the graphs of these these speakers, and they perform admirably for their price. You can build them for as little as probably $1,500 out the door with all the materials, with the speakers, and with the amplification needed to drive them, and of course, the digital signal processor, the DSP. I spent a little more money than most, probably. I have quarter-inch steel as the base. I think it looks much better. We're really proud of the way they turned out. This is just PVC, spray-painted PVC, and it looks really, really good. And then I actually 3D printed these baffle pieces. This was with my old 3D printer. 3D printer technology has improved quite a bit. And so I've been meaning to one of these days pull them back apart and reprint them. But I think they look really, really nice. And they've worked for the probably 3 or 4 years now that I've had them. They're fantastic speakers. They sound incredible. And every time people hear them, they're like, those are less than $1,000. I know that sounds like a lot of money for people who are not into hi-fi, and it is, but they outperform basically everything in its price point. And then I've got these bad boys. These are subwoofers. Subwoofers, people don't really know how they're supposed to work. There's this perception because of the way like pop culture is that subwoofers are like, they're shaking all the windows and whatever. But a good subwoofer is really, really quiet. In fact, you don't really notice they're even moving at all. It just adds a little bit extra to the bottom end. And so I have two subwoofers, which seems overkill, but it makes these speakers, which are otherwise lacking a little bit in the low end, just a little bit tighter. I built all of this stuff and it's been holding up really, really well. If you want to build your own, and I really recommend it, it's an amazingly fun project. And this speaker setup, I don't think can be matched for even $5,000 to $7,000. I mean, you have to spend 10 grand before you're getting stuff that sounds this good, which is pretty cool. I'll link the build down below and I strongly recommend you go check it out. It was a lot of fun and I have zero regrets. Powering those speakers is this stack of hardware, and it all kind of works in tandem. First up, we have the Outlaw 7125, which is actually a home theater amplifier. It is a standalone amplifier. There is no input control. There's no volume control. There's no source control. It's just an amplifier. And it works really well for that purpose as an amplifier for these speakers. But it's not a hi-fi amplifier. It's nothing really all that special, but it has more than enough wattage to drive the speakers. And it sounds really, really excellent. Above that, we have what's called a DSP, a digital signal processor. And this is a bit of a weird piece of kit. Every speaker requires what's called a crossover. A crossover essentially tells the speaker what frequency range to reproduce. Historically, most crossovers have been analog. They've been resistors, a physical, mechanical, analog a device. But this is a digital signal processor, meaning that it's IC-based. There's logic, there is a bunch of different stuff that you can modify to make it sound exactly the way you want. And so for DIY setups like the one I've created, it's a really great idea to get a DSP because you can, in software, modify exactly how the speakers sound to match the sound signature that you're seeking. It's really nice when your engineering is a little imprecise, which all DIY projects can be. On top of that, I just have a crappy, well, it's not crappy, I guess, because it's lasted about 20 years, a Monster Power power strip. These, I think, are mostly bogus. You do benefit slightly from using a power conditioner, but not as much as hi-fi guys will like you to think. They even spend money on, you know, these outrageous cables that, you know, have purity and there's silver in them. And never mind the fact that it's coming out of their wall, which is basically a coat hanger with electricity running through it. So I think the power is a bunch of crap. And that's why I have something that looks nice and provides, of course, a little bit of protection if I have outages or brownouts or spikes or surges, but nothing that's, you know, special or hi-fi. Above that, this is actually a PC. It is a fanless PC. The case is, of course, from Streecom, which I've done a couple of Hackintosh builds in their cases. This one also is fanless. I think it fits really, really nicely in the setup. Inside, I'm running an Intel 7100. It's just an i3 processor, but that's all I need to run the software, which is called Rune. Rune is both incredibly offensive and amazing all at the same time. We'll talk about that momentarily. And then above that, I've got my preamplifier here. This is from Nuforce. It's sadly discontinued. You can't get these anymore, but it was really, really great at the time and still is. And then above that, I have a little custom box that I put Hagerman Labs electronics equipment in. One is an MC step-up for my turntable, which if you don't know what that is, that's fine, who cares? And then a PhonoStage for my turntable. And then of course the turntable itself is a VPI Prime. I think this is about as good of a turntable as you can get for the money. It is expensive, but I've heard turntables that cost much more money than this one does, and I think they sound worse. And there's no way I will ever spend more money than this on a turntable. I think it's already overkill and it sounds super excellent. And then the cartridge, really what matters is more important than the turntable, is the DynaVector 17D. It is a moving coil cartridge, and it is super, super awesome, and I really, really like it. And that's basically it in this stack. Let's head over to the reel-to-reel deck. Okay, this is the newest piece of gear that I have in my setup. Well, it's not the newest, it's my latest acquisition. This thing is actually almost 40 years old. It was manufactured in 1980, and it is actually one of the coolest reel-to-reel decks out there, because this was kind of at the end of reel-to-reel's dominance in the high-end consumer world. This was a really high-end prosumer, entry-level professional deck. Cost thousands of dollars back when it was new, insanely expensive. And they're actually still pretty expensive now. I got a crazy good deal on mine, like half of what they normally go for. But you look on eBay and these are going serviced for about $3,000. They are not cheap. But one of the reasons they're so cool is that it has the ability, let's turn this on, to do a couple things that most reel-to-reel decks can't do. So one thing it can do is it can play in both directions. That's very unusual for reel-to-reel decks. So there are two tape heads. There's one on this side, one on this side. It, of course, is capable of recording, which most decks from the era were able to do. This is why it was kind of popular amongst audiophiles, is you could record your own tapes, which is pretty sweet. But another thing that it was able to do is it had an auto-reverse functionality. One of the problems with reel-to-reel decks, beyond having to flip it around and go in the other direction, which this one, again, does both, is this has a quartz lock through IC Logic. So there's actually logic boards. There's modern digital technology inside this system. It has a LED strobe here that's actually measuring the rate at which the tape goes. And you'll see the tape just reversed direction. So normally, on a normal reel-to-reel deck, when the time that you hit the end of the tape or you fast forward too far, it just rolls straight off. But on this, it actually detects that the tape has ended and will reverse it into the other direction, which makes recording in multiple directions just super handy. It's a really, really high-end piece of kit. It sounds incredible for its age. Really, they all sound incredible, and it's become one of my favorite pieces of gear. Is it practical? No. Is it something that most people would want? Probably not, but I think it's pretty cool. Oh, and then we have some headphones over here, which let's talk about those and then get out of here. It's been too long. Headphones were really kind of how I got into hi-fi, and so it's still probably the area where I have the most amount of money invested. And this equipment is really, really bananas. I have three amplifiers by my bedside table so that I can listen to music in bed, which is pretty cool. Rune is the piece of software that I use to basically control all of this stuff, and it controls my main setup as well. I'm going to talk about Rune in a second, but think of Sonos on crack. It's a really powerful piece of software. The reason it's offensive is its price tag. It's $500 for a lifetime subscription, or about $120 per year, which is a lot of money for software. But it works so well that I have a hard time not recommending it. So in order to run that software, because you need a client-side device, I use something like a Raspberry Pi, but I had this quiet Hackintosh build running an Intel NUC that I just reflashed with the Linux-based software and firmware that Rune uses. Next to it, I have a source select that allows me to toggle between the three different amplifiers. I have a Resonescence Concerto HD digital to analog converter. DACs are a fickle thing nowadays. I think China is making some of the best DACs that are available, and you can get incredibly good digital to analog converters for about $80 to $100. There are DACs out there that cost many times $800, which is bananas. But you can get stuff relatively inexpensively now. And every device you have ever heard has a DAC. You have to convert ones and zeros into an analog signal somehow. But the quality of the digital to analog converter can drastically affect how the final product sounds. But DACs have come down in price a lot over the last few years, and Chinese companies, which are operating on low margins with really, really, really great design, are making some really cheap digital to analog converters. I just bought one for my main setup, the Topping D70, which is not inexpensive at $400, but it outperforms DACs from American and European companies that are $10,000. $400. It's pretty amazing what China is pulling off. And the three amplifiers I have here power three different headphones. This one right here is the Woo GES. This is an amazing piece of kit. Woo Audio is one of my favorite amplifier brands of all time. Their stuff is just super excellent. The build quality is amazing. It looks beautiful. And this bad boy powers my Stax headphones. I actually have a vintage pair of Stax that I use here at the house. At the office, I am using the Stax that I purchased through Taobao, directly from China, that I got about half off, which is pretty cool. And then the amplifier below that is an Arlic Taurus Mark II. Arlic is actually a Chinese company, and they have been making really killer stuff, and they've been really highly respected in the hi-fi world ever since their inception about 10 years ago. This is one of the best solid-state amplifiers I think you can get, period. It is very expensive. They have come down on the used market quite a bit, and I think this is about as good as a headphone amplifier as you would ever need. It's spectacular. And then last but certainly not least, we have the COS ESP95X. That's a Mastrop exclusive. The ESP950 are electrostatic headphones, just like the Stax, and I think they're some of the best headphones money can buy. They're $500 and they sound incredible. The problem is that the stock amplifier, the one that I have here, isn't amazing, and you would be better off buying a Stax amplifier. And so I actually have a cable that allows me to plug these headphones directly into the Woo GES, and it's a pretty slick setup. Let's talk about how I stream all this music using Rune, and then we'll sign off. I don't want to sound like a Rune fanboy, but I'm honestly probably going to end up sounding like a Rune fanboy. Rune is one of the most cool and powerful pieces of software I've ever used, and I didn't buy it for years because of the price tag, but I'm sad I didn't purchase it earlier because it really is fantastic. You do need to run the Rune Core software on a computer located on your network. It can be a Mac or Windows computer or a Linux computer. So the i3-7100-based PC that I have in my hi-fi setup, that is running Arch Linux, and I have installed the RuneCore software on that as a dedicated machine. But you can install it on a shared computer if you want. Once you've installed the core software, you can see all of your devices on your network. So not only can you output to the core devices inside of your house, I have one at my hi-fi setup, and then I have one at my bedside table setup, which I've shown you. And those devices can output in really high resolution files because this software is built for high fidelity. It can play a bunch of crazy file formats that audio files use, like DSD and all sorts of shenanigans. But it also, one of the reasons I like it is it allows you to interface with basically every other device on your network. Chromecast device, I've got an AirPlay device, I've got Sonos devices. Rune doesn't care. It works with everything. And that's one of the reasons it's cool is if you're in multiple ecosystems, it's really nice to be able to use one piece of software to control everything. And then beyond that, it's just super powerful. You can see an album. Not only can you see the list and queue stuff as you would be able to, but it shows you related albums. It gives you bios on the artists themselves. It gives you credits. The whole idea behind Rune is to kind of bring back this resurgence that we've seen in vinyl, because vinyl is something tactile. You can see the album art. You can see liner notes. You can read a bunch of stuff on an LP that you can't really see when you're streaming something on Spotify. And they try to bring back that experience digitally. And I think they do a really, really nice job. The album art is well displayed. The system is super easy to navigate. And then once you're playing back, there's a bunch of view options. So you can see the album art, you can see a picture of the artist. More interestingly, you can read album reviews from professional critics as you're listening to the album. You can read about the bios, read bios about the artists. And then last but certainly not least, there's actually live lyrics that you can read while you are listening to the song. And the lyrics engine is really powerful. There is a lot of lyrics available, and it's just a really, really cool app. I can't even really get into how much stuff is available in here. You even look at the settings section, and it gives you an idea of how advanced this crap is. It just gets crazy how much kind of usability there is. I'm like, look at all the settings. There's just a ton. It goes way deeper than I'm even able to go. And so it's a really cool piece of software, and it brings this whole hi-fi experience together, because no matter where I am in my house, I can listen to the music that I want to listen to and view it in a more interactive way. Rune is super cool, and the price tag is rough. But if you're willing to get over that, I think it's a really slick system. Well, that's all for me. Thank you so much for watching. I gotta pack and get ready to go to LTX. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. If you didn't, well, that other button seems to work okay too. Get subscribed for more awesome tech videos like these, but most importantly, and as always, stay snazzy.